Hello and welcome to the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined, I'm the second most handsome man in the room, clearly. Mm-hmm. I'm in the room by myself, actually. That's even scarier. But in the Zoom room, second most handsome. So I'm joined on this edition by the most handsome man in sports entertainment. It's the Sam Barbour Experience. Welcome to the show.
Hello, thank you for having me, Billy.
I'm very excited for this. When I was going through, pretty much when I get guests, because I'm quite anxious with actually asking people, I go through people that follow me first. That's always the best way. So right. Then the next one is, who's got their emails open? Great, that's fine, you're next. And thankfully you have, and thankfully you answered. So we've got you on. And when I was going through, when I go through my research, I'm like, Sam Barbour, I've heard the name, I haven't seen you wrestle live, unfortunately. But I thought, okay, he's done a few things. This will be fun. And then I was going through your cage match profile and going, Jesus, he's fair packed in quite a lot.
Yeah, I've done not too bad for myself. This has been 5-6 years on now. From my debut.
2016. Are you just discounting 2021 entirely, kind of that whole 18-month weirdness?
Yeah, probably just discount that. Mm-hmm. Didn't happen. Yeah, not all happened anyway. So,
So the first question we ask is, unfortunately, it's the most cliche wrestling question you get on a podcast. But I've got to know, how did you get into pro wrestling? What was the moment that got you hooked?
I can't define a singular moment that got me hooked into wrestling. However, I can say that it was like my dad who was into wrestling, and from that, because he was into wrestling, it got me into wrestling as well. So, and I have this vivid memory of being given SmackDown, the PlayStation 1 game, as a present for Easter, because my family done Easter presents. I'm a privileged child, what can I say? However, my mum and dad were separated, so I got given it just before Easter, and I got told not to play it before Easter Day for some reason. Like, they're treating it like a birthday. And it was a bit sneaky, and I played it before Easter Day. So I got into trouble for that. And that wasn't even my first wrestling game as well, so I can't define when I started liking wrestling. But like it's just kind of like taking me from there. And I've like some of my most vivid childhood memories revolve around wrestling as well, and it's something that I've grown up with, something that like I absolutely adore, and that's why I pursue it, you know. Something I said that I'm very passionate about, ever since I was a young age. So that must have been when I was 4 at least, I've actually still got the game as well, much like as I guess the trend now. I have all my retro consoles in another room, and with that, the full game collection as well. So,
I don't think I can get away. I mean, this is my little corner of wrestling stuff. I don't think I can get away with that. The whole game system is a dream. It's obviously the dream, but
of course,
there's two people in this house, and she's in charge.
So that belt behind you as well, that European title belt. So when I was younger, that was my first replica belt as well. It wasn't like the metal one, but it was like the plastic one. So I remember like cutting about with it in my house. A wee bit of kind of background, I used to stay in a flat. So I didn't like go out and play anything at all. I was kind of confined to the flat. So my best friend was probably a 3-foot teddy bear, I guess, and I used to fling that about something awful and pretend I was the European champion as well. So I don't unfortunately have that anymore.
Oh, we all did it. We all did. I mean, my family were just we made do kind of thing. I find creative ways to get my wrestling fix in, whether it was just going to a friend's house and that. I made myself a hardcore belt out of cardboard. But my mate had he had plastic ones as well. He had a smoking skull belt,
nice,
which was amazing.
And always he had that.
The WWF Tag Team Championship as well.
Cool.
So we were always, if I was going up to his, we'd always end up like wrestling in. They had a bigger garden, so we'd end up wrestling there, or because that's where we'd have to be, because we start up in his bedroom and we get chucked out doing the grass instead. And I ended up, when I went to my first wrestling show, he kind of fell out of wrestling. I was like, right. Have you still got those belts? And he went, I think so. Yeah, find them. Oh, I'll give you like a tenner for them.
Yeah.
So I've ended up behind the European belt. I'll see if I can get out, actually. Because I've got loads of her crap in here as well. End up with it.
Nice. That's so class.
That is. Amazing. How old is it now? 2000. So I probably got it. Yeah, a little lot after that, and end up getting it signed by Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
Hey,
and Billy nice. Gunn. Because Hacksaw asked, and you don't say no to Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
No, definitely not, no. So. And Billy Gunn, by the way, he is monstrous. Like, I did not realise how big he is. So I met him a few times, actually. And so I got my picture with him as well, just because I was like, when am I ever actually going to get to see Billy Gunn again? And one of the cardinal rules is, oh, you don't get photos with imports and stuff like that. But I'm like, nah, like, it's Billy Gunn. Like, he was one of my favourites when I grew up. So I've got this Polaroid of me standing next to Billy Gunn, and I am like shoulder height, and I'm like just a touch under 6 foot. And like Billy Gunn is towering over me, and like, so he's that tall, but he's just so wide as well. It's like monstrous, crazy.
I've got the same picture, obviously, of me, not of you. That'd be weird. Yeah. But you know, I got that, that's when I got that signed. My first wrestling show in Aberdeen, WrestleZone show in Aberdeen, and that's when I met Hacksaw and I met Billy Gunn, and yeah, like you're saying, met Billy Gunn. I'm 5'10", just about 5'10", and to see the size of this man was just like. You don't look that big on TV. There yeah. You are. But same with any wrestlers. I mean, Chavo Guerrero was the other one that comes to my mind when I saw him, and I was like, he was shorter than me, but he was huge. He was like broad, and he could just rip you apart if he really wanted to. And back in my youth, I said some really nasty things about him on Twitter, so he really wouldn't remember me. But no, he was really nice. But so early favorites then. So you had SmackDown. You said SmackDown game wasn't your first one though. What did you have? Do you remember what you had before?
Yeah, it must have been Warzone. Right. So I think because I ended up like coming in possession of all of them anyway. But I had Warzone and had Attitude. So I was a PlayStation boy growing up. So yeah, I had Warzone and I had Attitude. But I actually think I had Attitude first, and then I got Warzone. Because the reason why I remember that was because when I got it, The Rock was like the people's champ, The Rock. And then when I got Warzone, they turned up Rocky Maivia, and I was like, who's this? Like, this isn't like The Rock that I know. You know, that's like original gimmick Rock. And I'm like, nah, I didn't kind of like understand it at the time because I was such a young guy. And that's when, in Warzone as well, Triple H had the long tights. Yep. As well, which like I didn't understand either, because when I started getting into wrestling, he had like the trunks essentially. And the first feud I remember was The Rock and Triple H. And I know you said like something's going in tangents and stuff like that, and hopefully this does somewhat answer the question as well. But so my favorite growing up and probably favorite now is The Rock. Like, he is like so charismatic, like, I'm just kind of like drawn to him. And like The Rock Triple H is like my defining childhood feud, if you get me. Everyone says, oh no, it's always like Rock and Austin, and obviously they main evented, but like one of the biggest crimes is the fact that like Rock and Triple H never had a one-on-one at WrestleMania, because the only time they ever faced each other at WrestleMania, as you may know, is WrestleMania 2000, when it was a McMahon in every corner. And that was also the first WrestleMania that I remember as well. Like, that's when I used to stay up every Friday night and watch Raw on Sky Sports 1, and wake up the next morning and SmackDown was on Sky 1.
Oh yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, so it was around about then that was being allowed to stay up late. So WrestleMania 2000, I believe, was my first WrestleMania that I remember.
Do you ever find that, because when you get older, of course, and you get a little bit more in the know with all this kind of stuff, and you became a wrestler, so you have a little bit more in the know-ness about it. Do you ever find when you hear all these like kind of critics and journalists and whatever they want to call themselves, like Slate, in your case, WrestleMania 2000, you're like, no, that big nostalgia feel to it. Cause mine, WrestleMania 15, which is hailed as probably one of the worst ones, but I love it because it was my first WrestleMania. The best thing ever.
What was the main event for 15?
It was Rock Austin, but it was the first Rock Austin.
Right, yeah. I think like people just kind of come to the product, and not even just like critics and like casuals, but like just with different eyes as well. Like, so like for the likes of like my peers, essentially, like they view a thing and like, oh, there was no like story building, there was no like. That was just like a big spot fest and stuff like that. But do you know, like different folks, different strokes. Like I live by that. Like wrestling should be a variety show, 100%. And if, for example, WrestleMania 2000, if that wasn't up to like Dave Meltzer's like cup of tea, then like who cares? You know, it's going to be like thousands, like hundreds of thousands of other people's cup of tea, and like that's what they remember fondly as well. So. Like I do understand like that's like some people's jobs to kind of rate it and stuff like that, but you don't necessarily need to agree with it. It's just one person's opinion.
Exactly. That's the way to do it. It's like anyone that I sometimes do reviews of shows, I try to be, if I'm going to be critical, I try to at least put a spin on it, you know, like, because again, I've never done it. So who am I to really judge, but I know what I feel, you know?
Yeah.
That's kind of way I go by it. If I didn't, if thought this wasn't great, but I always try to put to me, because I know, so because when I go to shows, it might be a match I didn't like, but there's three kids that are the loudest people in the room that cheered the whole time. So I'm like, someone did. So cool. That's your thing. Anyway, this isn't going to be me ranting about people whinging on the internet. So we'll move on. So you went from watching, you went from playing the games. Attitude was probably my first one as well. I remember the red cover to it.
Yeah,
I loved playing. This, again, off topic, off tangent, where I'm going, but I remember In Your House as well. It was, I think it was called Bango's Neighborhood. No, that was Backyard Wrestling. But In Your House, and they have like superpowers and stuff like that as well.
Yeah, I have never played that game, but I've wanted to so much. So I've I've tried to find like an emulator that I could do it, because it looks so cool. It's like obviously Mortal Kombat, but wrestling, original Mortal Kombat, you know, because it's like the actual pictures of people. And like, the superpowers just, they look class. Like I've seen videos of other people playing it, but I've never actually got to play it myself. So that obviously must be like some game.
Yeah, I mean, I thought it didn't exist for a long time. I thought like a Mandela effect fever dream that I imagined this game, and then I finally saw it. I think Undertaker at some point hits you with a casket and then buries you, and it comes up with a little R.I.P. gravestone. From what I remember, it's just absolute nuts. But how'd you go from them playing the games and wrestling with your teddy bear, which we've all done? Don't lie if you're listening to this, you have. How'd you go from that to actually going, you know what, I'm going to try this? Now, I know I was going to fall into a trap saying you started GPWA, but I listened to ESSR, Eat, Sleep, Suplex, Retweet this morning, and you didn't start at GPWA. You started at Source.
Yes, I did start at Source, yeah. Now, the Eat, Sleep, Suplex, Repeat podcast was a while ago, so I don't know. I've not listened to it. Like,
it was 2018. I was looking back thinking,
wow,
there's a lot has happened since 2018.
you're right, a lot's happened. So that's when I started off. And it's a bit foggy as to, I did go a few times, but it was a bit foggy as to who was the coach when I packed it in. So I think maybe about, I don't know, 2012, I think that I went to Source. And as I said, I did go a few times. So one session was, and I'll just name names. One session was Jam O'Malley. Another session was Michael Whiplash, and another session was Demo. And you know what? I was enjoying it. It was cool. And it was my first kind of foray into wrestling. And I said that, like, I wrestled my teddy bear before, and I've got a younger sister as well. And I don't think I said this in the last podcast as well, but my sister and I, we wrestled as well. She's an aggressive person, so she just loved to fight. She didn't really care for wrestling at all, you know. So, like, if I was doing moves, she was like, right, cool, punch. You know, I was like, all right, okay, cool. So there's a wee bit of an age difference between us. There's 5 years between us. And on more than one occasion, it ended up in the result to the A&E. So my sister, now has a dodgy shoulder because I have dislocated her arm not once but twice. And on the second visit to the hospital, the doctor actually said, right, cool, this could actually be a problem. So one, camera sundown, and two, actually showed my dad how to pop my sister's arm back in place as well, just in case it does happen again. Which is, I mean, cool, but I mean, it was bad when the doctor's showing you how to pop your daughter's arm back in because your son's a bit like wrestling obsessed. So thankfully, in wrestling, I've not taken it to those extremes. I've not ripped anyone's arm out the socket, which is good. But yeah, so a number of years after we went to A&E, I seen this advert on Facebook, I think it was, and ended up going to Source. Went a few times, really enjoyed it. And then one session, because I hadn't really done much then, because it wasn't like GPWA is where like everyone comes in on the same level. There was mixed experience levels. So for myself, I was coming fresh. I didn't know how to bump, how to kind of fall properly, protect myself. So we were doing this drill and it was a case of running, take a tackle and then fall. So we're doing it. And then I fall too hard. Like, so someone just goes through me thinking of the big man, and I'm not going to name names because that's just a bit disrespectful, but someone goes through me, I take a fall and I knock my head so bad that I have one eye facing forward, one eye facing that way. So, and I'm in a Wynwood at the time, so when I drive home I need to actually drive with one hand over my eye so I can see straight, because I literally cannot straighten my eyes at all. And I can only blink with one eye as well. And I can only blink with the good eye. So that's why I literally had to drive one-handed on my way back. And then after that, I was like, you know what, this probably isn't for me, because I went to the hospital the next day and they said, yeah, you've got a severe concussion. And it lasted 2 days. And to be honest, ever since then, like sometimes I do get a wee bit dizzy from time to time. It just kind of, it shows you, like, everyone knows there is kind of negative connotations of concussions in wrestling, and that was just one concussion, and that's kind of me gubbed essentially.
I mean, go back a little bit, the start of that story, your sister, all I had in my head was you really going, see, this is a figure four leg lock, I turn your leg here, and she's just going, no, I'm just going to kick you.
That's, yep.
That's yep. What's going to happen here. It kind of got you used to the real life aspect of wrestling and how a little bit silly it is sometimes.
yeah, just a wee bit. She's like, no, not happening for me. You can grab my leg if you want, but I'm going to like kick you off. So,
But no, the concussion thing. Well, not to downplay the concussion thing, because that's quite a bit of serious out of the two there. So now you say you get a little bit dizzy nowadays. Is that at least you recognise that? It could be worse. You could just, you're smart enough to not like power through it, like be the big man and go, no, it's fine, just a little bit dizzy. You're very you're smart enough just to go, I feel dizzy, no, give myself a minute here and just get my bearings back. Has that ever kind of stopped anything in the future? Have you been in the middle of a match and felt it and just think, right, I need to kind of cut this short?
No, I'd say that, like, this sounds big-headed, but like, I'm that much of like a professional, like I know where I am, that like if anything like that does happen to me, then I can take a wee second and I can communicate that properly as well. Thankfully, it's not really happened in a match, so I've not had to worry about it. But on like the very, very, very odd occasion where it has, I'm like, right, cool. And it's not put myself or my opponent in danger at all, because that's the number one rule. Like, as stupid as it sounds, like, you don't care for yourself, you just keep your opponent safe, and that's it, and then you hope that's reciprocated as well. So number one priority is to keep like the person who's standing across from me safe, and that's what I do.
So how did you decide then that GPWA, so you took a break from that then because of course of that, but when you saw GPWA, I think you said in that interview you were the third intake, so you've seen it come in and see who was kind of starting off. But why did you go back?
So it's I kind of an itch that I just had to scratch, you know. It was always going to be that what if, like, because you always think to yourself, like, do you know, I should have done this, I should have done that. And, like, I'm really glad that I went for it, because wrestling has been very good to me. So I seen that advert on Facebook, and it said, we're taking our next intake in March. And I'm like, right, okay, I'm going to go for it. I'd been to a couple of wrestling shows before, and the people that I knew from the poster, so it was like kind of the original five coaches, I thought, right, cool, if I'm going to wrestle, then that's who I want to get in with as well. And it was really good because it was like really detailed on the website about how training was structured as well, and how, like, all of the coaches had an input into the training. So it wasn't a case of, right, you're just wearing this style, this one style, and that's it, because that can get, like, a bit monotonous, and it isn't great for your growth as a wrestler, as a character and stuff like that. So I've seen the advert and I thought, it's not, I'm going to go for it, and I'm glad I did. And in that intake, it was that's where Sam Barbour versus Ravy Davy started, because him and I were in the same intake, and that's where that rivalry's kind of started from. Because it's like both Davy and I were very competitive, like, and we just wanted to show the coaches that, like, we were the best in the class. Essentially, not quite teacher's pet, but just like, I'm more athletic, I'm kind of more coachable and stuff like that. So that's where it started, and it's still going all these years on.
It's that fight forever.
It's my fight forever.
So yeah, so when you say that, of course, I've spoken, is that the right word? I've chatted with sounds better. With a bunch of other guys from GPWA, like Mikey Devine and Robert Romero and guys like that, and pretty much came to the agreement of exactly what you're saying. GPWA offers such a wide range of styles, because not one from the original five coaches, especially, you would never say any of them were the same. As in, Lionheart's style was completely far and away different to BT Gunn's. Even some overlaps, and again, Wolfgang bigger, but there's still, you can do a little bit of everything, and of course you've got Rudo, who's got the mic work, and you've got and obviously Jester, because I've mentioned everyone else, would be as well mentioned Jack Jester as well, who's got the hardcore style as well, so he knows how to kind of take the lumps and take the pain safely, generally, as well. So yeah, you've got a little bit of a bit of everything in that kind of style, in that kind of environment. What was it like taking that first bump then? So you had your stuff at Source. Was there any trepidation coming in? Or again, was it just like, no, I need to get this itch scratched, I'm going to just throw myself into it?
Oh, undoubtedly. You didn't actually... So it was an eight-week course when I started. I think since then it's now moved to a 10-week course potentially. But that's by the by. So we didn't actually do our first bump until week two or week three. And the first week, that was kind of getting to know everyone in the class. I think showing you how to walk up as well. And it was a bit of a disclaimer as well. And you had to say if you had any ailments, any previous like wrestling experience, and any injuries. And I didn't actually disclose the fact that I suffered from concussions. But to be fair, it'd been like 2 or 3 years since then, and I hadn't taken a similar fall, essentially. In those years, I didn't want to practice in my garden, essentially, before I went. But yeah, with that kind of that memory lingering in the back of my head of having to drive half an hour with one eye open, there was definitely some trepidation in taking that first bump. And it went smoothly, it went good. Probably not the smoothest, because you've still got that wee bit of doubt, so like the last second is a bit like, but it went well, I survived, I didn't get a concussion there, and we just kind of went on from there.
Yeah, so that moment though must have kind of been a bit of a relief then, as in you hit the ground, whatever, and you're like, that's fine, yeah, I've got this now. I mean, of course you still have your spells, like you say, but you know how to safely manage them and keep your opponent safe, and yourself, obviously, two of the more important things. Oh, hang on. Drew's trying to escape my desk here. Right. So you started up again and you made your debut. I've got here Night of the Asylum 2 with Ravy Davey. I'm going to guess against GPWA. I'm guessing there was a gala at some point, a battle royal maybe.
Yeah, you're right, actually. So that is what it was. I think so, anyway. Because there was a battle royal. That must have been Night of the Asylum 2 then. And it was Davey and I to be the last two.
Sorry, mate. That was the match. I mean, beforehand, I'm guessing there was like a gala day at like Alexander Park or something like that. Beforehand, is your actual like your unofficial debut?
So no, that was my second match. Sorry. Right, get confused. So Sam Barbour's official debut was in a battle royale before, but however, there is a mask luchador under the guise of El Gingero that made his debut at Denison Galladay. And what happened was I was actually on holiday with lots of my friends, and I got a flight home 2 days earlier just so I could make it. So I was in France with my friends doing some volunteer work, and got a flight 2 days earlier than everyone else and made it to Denison for the gala day, and debuted as El Gingero. So he turned out to be a bit of a Denison gala day hero. The main event of the main event, the main event of the Battle Royal. So he only ever appears when there's a Denison Battle Royal. But however, so then after that, I had a battle royale in which Davey and I were the last two as well at Night of the Asylum 1. And I think Davey won that one, actually. But here's a wee bit behind the curtain. So I was supposed to get eliminated like well before. And the fact that I brought the most people to Night of Asylum, got told, right, okay, cool, you may as well just be in the final two then. And that was quite good, because in battle royales, it's just a case that you get to do like a wee bit and then right off you pop and you go. Whereas when you're the final two, as you know, there can be a bit of a mini match, a wee bit of storytelling, and it was cool just to be able to kind of showcase that as well. And it wasn't even my own tights that I wore during that match as well. I had to borrow some tights because it got kind of thrown up on me that I was going to be in the final two. Because if I wasn't in the final two, then I was just going to go El Gingero. But the fact that I was in the final two, I was like, right, okay, cool. There you go. Sam Barbour Experience. So that's Night of Asylum 1. Night of Asylum 2 was Ravy versus I. And then the next night in Newcastle was my ICW debut as well. You might have that in your notes. Yeah, so I was helping at ICW as part of the ring crew, driving down, and one of the rules is you always bring your gear. But I thought, right, I've only had one match, like, why would I bring my gear? So we're probably about at Carlisle, and I've got Scott Reed in the car, and Scott goes, oh, by the way, I don't know if you were told this, and this is like 2.5-3 years into the journey, or we want you in the pre-show match. And I'm like, what? I said, yeah, we want you. And I was like, I literally just had my first match last night, but they got good feedback from it, saying it was really good, and I went on the show. I was like, that's great, amazing. I don't have my gear. Like, oh, what, you didn't bring your gear? I said, well, you know, it's only like my first match, like, why would I carry my gear with me? So my mum had to drop off my gear at the asylum, and then Wolfgang brought my gear down for me so I could have my my first ICW match, which is really cool. It was cool the fact that my second ever singles match was for ICW in essentially a different country as well, and the
O2
Academy.
Exactly. It's the fight forever. We'll probably get on to more matches with Ravy Davies, or moments where you guys have crossed paths as we go along. But Yes, of course, that match, Newcastle was against Ravy Davy as well. And then you ended up in Night Asylum 4. I think you were the, am I right in thinking you were the first student only main event as
Yes.
Well?
Uh-huh. That was it. So we, Davy and I, were the two kind of flag bearers of GPWA. We were the faces of GPWA. And we were trusted enough to represent the brand in the first student only main event. So with that, there had to be like, I like to be a bit of a showman. So with that, there had to be like theatrics, you know. And there was more theatrics on the night that we hadn't like planned or anything at all, which just kind of added so much to the match as well. But that is where the infamous Lion King entrance came from. So I had I bought two Rafiki masks, and I got carried out to the ring with the Lion King theme playing. I can't even remember the name of the theme. I can remember the intro, but I can't even remember the name of the Lion King theme.
So is it your classic Arsene Wenger one?
Yeah. Okay. That's on. So I got carried out to that, and before I even take a step in the ring, Davey like spears me through the ropes, like Big E style, and then that's a match from there. So that's probably the match Night of the Silent Four is the match that I hold the fondest memories of, because one, it was like the first like all student main event. I got to share the ring with some of my friends as well, because it turned into like a bit of a schmoz, and the whole event led to that main event, essentially. So all the stories kind of intertwined. And like I brought so many people to it, so many people got to witness it. And like the drama in it as well, because that's all kind of wrestling is as well. Like to me, you know, it's all about the storytelling, it's all about the drama. And I caught Davey with such a punch that he just burst open, like one snug punch right there, and burst him open. And then so the blood kind of elevated everything as well. It heightened the emotions. There was receipts as well. So I left with like a very, very black eye. Like at one point I actually thought that he broke my orbital bone, like the Undertaker, because within like touching me, it just went boom. Thankfully I wasn't bleeding. But that lasted about 2-3 weeks, and because it was so inflamed at the time, one of the wrestlers thought it'd be a good idea to get a Stanley blade and like just cut it open.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Thankfully I never done that, because it Sam that needs strained because it's so big. I was like, no, I'm all right. I think I'm gonna just get it seen to it. I was like, no, it'll be fine. Honestly, I've done this before. Just cut it, and I'm like, you're all right. I'm not gonna cut my eye.
Was there a part of you that after maybe a week, saying the Undertaker thing, was there a part of you just like, who can make masks for protection, and then just coming back with a dazzled mask?
So it wasn't the Undertaker mask, but I definitely did do a wee bit of research, and I spent hours researching as well. So after that, the thing that I really, really, really wanted was the Cody Rhodes mask. When he had like the all clear face mask, because I really wanted that. The only face masks I could find, unfortunately, were like plastic ones. It was kind of like white plastic, or if it was like clear, it'd be like clear here, but then like plastic on the nose, which just wouldn't look as good. But yeah, that was going to be like my next like gimmick, essentially. But I couldn't actually find a suitable mask, unfortunately.
So we were denied. We were denied it undashing.
Yes, exactly.
So the Sam Barbour Experience then. So an mm-hmm. absolute different thing that because everyone has a name, or they have a like The Rock is The Rock, or The Miz, or their actual proper human name. But the Sam mm-hmm. Barbour Experience, something different.
Yeah.
Where did you come up with that kind of moniker?
So Sam Barbour Experience, like, so I wanted to keep my name, essentially. And I think at that Royal Rumble there, it shows why you maybe should keep your name in regards to Brock Lesnar and in regards to Bobby Lashley, and the fact that like all their accolades, like they've taken a name with them, whether it be like NCAA champion, whether it be like USC, Bellator. Like, so I really, really wanted to keep my name, but I thought Sam Barbour, that's a bit like, oh. So it was actually the Jimi Hendrix experience that I drew inspiration from. Now, being from Scotland, everyone thinks it's GBX, like the George Bowie experience. And that's where Billy Kirkwood thought I took the inspiration from as well. So when he's commented my matches with an ICW before, he's called my finisher Bits and Pieces because of GBX. But yeah, the Sam Barbour experience drew inspiration from the Jimi Hendrix experience. And sorry, it was originally supposed to be like kind of like psychedelic kind of vibes. And actually, it was supposed, like my original intention was supposed to be very, very, very similar to Velveteen Dream. Now, if you remember, Velveteen Dream didn't actually get introduced as Velveteen Dream at the start. His name was the Patrick Clark Experience. And after that, so when he had his name, Patrick Clark Experience, a few people actually tagged me, and it is also they're tagging me in like a WWE Superstars tweet, and like, oh, is he just copying you? And I was like, oh my days, like, and then literally the next week, it changed to Velveteen Dream. So, yeah, like, I'm not even lying. Like, I was shook by it. I was like, maybe he's seen this then. Like, and then he's like, nah, you know, I want to be original because that seems like the kind of person that he is. So, yeah, it was supposed to be very kind of Velveteen Dream, Jimi Hendrix, like, Prince inspired. And it ended up taking a bit of a life of its own, and the main inspiration was actually Zoolander. Zoolander is one of my favourite films, so that's where a lot of the characteristics of SBX comes from.
Well, and then of course the Frankie Says Relax kind of t-shirt. I mean, to be honest, I'm up in the northeast, I'm in North Scotland, so the George Bowie experience it means nothing to me, to be perfectly honest. So I was all about the Jimi Hendrix experience. That was the only one I'd heard of. So the fact that it's something different than what I thought of is even better, because I'm learning. I'm learning as we go in these things. That's what I like to do in these podcasts. I don't like to have all the answers because, you know, that's a terrifying thought in the world. So yeah, you said you started off, the plan was, so actually just rewind that. So you've obviously Patrick Clark, Velveteen Dream, mm-hmm. doesn't really wrestle much anymore for reasons, but he, in our minds here, he's checked out some Sam Barbour experience and went, nah, I'm not messing with that, I'm not messing with Sam Barbour, I'm just gonna become something else.
Honestly, I genuinely, like, no other way, think that it's these. Now people are just gonna say, like, you're talking rubbish, talking baloney, but I seen it the next week because I had like a very vested interest in it as well, because like I said, it was very similar to kind of what I was trying to do as well. And it changed the next week to Velveteen Dream, which like is a very cool name as well, but it didn't fit in with like my original ethos of like I wanted to keep my name. So it worked for him at the time, you know. So
you also formed a little tag team as well with C.S. Rose, who I think he does quite a lot of, he's quite a big blogger now with his journalism. Yeah. And you faced, you know, just the coffees. You know, just the coffees. What was it like? So it's the Handsome Man's Club.
Handsome Man's Club.
You called yourselves, and you're coming up against Mark and Joe Coffee, mm-hmm. of course, now in NXT UK. And but before that point, we're probably some of the biggest names in Scottish wrestling, right, with WWE. What was it like getting told you're getting this match with the Coffees, and what was the thought?
So that wasn't the original match. That was that was scheduled. So the original match was Handsome Man's Club, SBX and CSOs versus One Joe Coffee and One Noam Dar. So for some reason, it was Joe Coffey and Noam Dar in a tag match versus the Handsome Man's Club. They were already scheduled anyway, but we got put against them. And the reason why Noam Dar couldn't make it was because the night before, he was getting flown to New York to sit at SummerSlam because he'd just been signed by WWE. So that's kind of the match that got away from me that I'm so gutted about, that I've never faced Noam Dar in the ring before. Like, I've been on shows with him before, but I've never been in the ring with him. So that was the original match, and we, CS Rose and I, never got told until the day of who was going to be his replacement as well, because I didn't know whether it was going to be Mark, I didn't know whether it was going to be like Jackie Polo, whether it be whoever, you know, because it was quite a random matchup. Let's be honest, like Joe Coffey, Noam Dar, you wouldn't really put them two as a tag together. But then, yeah, so I didn't really have time to let it settle in, the fact that I was facing like the Coffees. So I just had to roll with it, but it was good. It was a good learning experience, and I've actually been in the ring with Joe multiple times now, as of us speaking, and every time is a learning experience. But that was the first time him and I shared the ring together, and it was my first tag match, I think, because before that I had a mixed tag match, and it was like myself and Molly Spartan versus Casey and Ravy, but I never had like an actual tag match where like him and I were cohesive as well. And with that, I said earlier, I like to be a bit of a showman, so it wasn't relaxed that it came out to. It was a One Edwin Starr's War, and we came out with the face paint and like combats, and a toy rifle as well, which I still have. So that got over as well, the entrance. That was good, and with that we drew inspiration from War Games. Because I've got this picture, and it was my wallpaper on my phone for the longest time, of Sting and Matchman Randy Savage like decked out in the camouflage for War Games. So I thought, I really, really want to do that. So we done that, and it was a good match. Like, in hindsight, I could have focused more on the match than the entrance. That's hindsight's always 2020, but I still felt that I had a good showing in what I'd done, and the fans went home happy at the end of the day. So that's the main thing, you know. As long as the paying customers are happy, that's all you can ask for. Like, there's always going to be one or two things that you can work on in the ring, as well. But it was good to share the ring with someone or people who are so experienced.
I absolutely get that. I mean, I know for myself, like, I love wrestling. I've loved wrestling for this point, was it 2022, started watching in 98, so 24 years I've watched wrestling, and all the way through, didn't have the grown-up break of it all. I was still there the whole way, and I've come to the point, much like we were discussing just before we hit record about the Rumble, when I watch wrestling, I switch off and just be entertained. And when you're saying that you felt you concentrate too much on, maybe too much on the showmanship of it all, I think I probably would have watched it and went, yeah, I love that, just because that's the bit I like. I like the wrestling, yeah. The wrestling's great, but I like the story, I like the almost the pantomime of it all. That's the bit I like about wrestling more. I mean, you can do 15 minutes of submissions, I'll probably be ace and I'll enjoy it, it'll be nice and smooth. But if you stand up and then point one way, one direction, slap them the other, 5 stars. That's my that's my cup of tea. Just the silliness of all. But no, speaking of Joe Coffey, you said you've had several matches with him. You've also had a non-title victory when he was ICW World Heavyweight Champion. I mean, correct. By DQ, but don't let facts get in the way of a story. I was going from that point onwards, though, after that Coffey match, your opponents, like the experience that you're getting in the ring with, like Kenny Williams, Jack Jester, Michael Chase, Shady Natras, of course, from Target, who's who's wrestled for the Donkey's okay, years
promotions.
Now.
Yeah.
And of course, I don't know if I already said, but Lionheart in 2017 as well. Were you really feeling like your confidence booming at that point, that you were getting to be on shows with these experienced guys? They were putting a lot of trust in you to be in the ring with them, because at the end of the day, you at the end of a match, you've both got to look good. So they're putting the trust in you to not make them look useless at the same time. So yeah, when you're getting all these big matches, was it just like your confidence just sky high?
So yeah, the fact that I was being given the matches, my confidence was sky high. In that Kenny Williams match, I actually got knocked out cold. So that was a very abrupt match, and to be honest, like, my confidence did take a big dip after that, and it took a while to get back in the swing of things. I just took a rogue boot to the face, essentially, and I was out cold for maybe like a split second, but I woke up and I was just like, nah, like, I'm staying down. Like, I just want, I didn't know where I was, and I was like, nah, like, I'm kind of tapping out here. And that might not be the mentality to have, but I just thought, like, cool, like, if I do that, then, like, I'm not putting anyone else in danger. Essentially, because I said, number one priority is to keep other people safe as well. And it was, like, no telling where, like, if I'd just been knocked out cold, whether I might take a dizzy turn kind of later on in the match as well. So my confidence did take a bit of a dip after that. But I've got back to my feet and a kind of mental capacity, and I was feeling real confident myself and my wrestling ability. The big turning point for me, like, was the Night of the Asylum tournament. That was the big thing for me, because that was very much I don't like to use the phrase, but a card subject to change atmosphere, and the fact that I wasn't supposed to go to the final. Like, that got called on the fly that night, just because of the following that I was garnering, essentially, because over those 2 days of that tournament, I got myself the most over with the fans. So I went into that tournament as a heel, as a bad guy. And by the end of it, I was like top babyface. Like, I just babyfaced everyone else out of the water, essentially. So that was a big turning point, because I went back through and everyone else was full of praise for me. Like, my coaches, my peers, everyone. And so after that, that's when I was like, right, okay, cool, I've got this, maybe I can do something. And then I got given the matches as well. And yeah, I think the most fun matches I've had were probably with Lionheart as well. Like, he's someone that I hold really dear at my heart, and he had a lot of trust in me himself as well. So yeah, he was just all about the entertaining as well. Like, we shared a similar, or the same, favourite wrestler as well. Both our favourite wrestlers were The Rock, so we could, like, laugh about that as well, and like, kind of try and work his moves into the match, and just have a bit of a laugh as well. Like, my big gimmick pre-pandemic was the lollipop. Now, I can't really do it anymore, but I used to shove my lollipop in people's mouth. I've wrestled Lionheart a few times now, and it was getting to the point where, like, the ways of getting the lollipop into his mouth, or perhaps into my mouth, or just getting more outlandish. So it was fun. You just kind of try to talk one another and make each other laugh during the match. So that was good. So, because, I mean, wrestling is about putting on a show, but you still need to love it. You still need to enjoy it at the end of the day. And, like, if you're not enjoying what you're doing, then you may as well just tap out and just kind of call it a day, you know. I know some people do take sabbaticals and then come back. And sometimes that's what you need to do, but you really do need to enjoy what you're doing in the ring. And if you aren't, it shows big time.
I think you kind of, you found the thing to get the crowd involved straight away, of course, with the Sam Barbour Experience. I mean, like I've already said, like I'm big into the outlandish, the character, the that kind of stuff. That's the bit I love, and I'm guessing that's, as it's proven with yourself, that's what the kids like. That's what the casual viewer like. They like the big characters. I mean, and not to say badly to anyone else, but there's a lot of wrestlers coming through that are just like, I am a wrestler. I'm a good wrestler. I've got black tights and kick pads. I'm going to do a wrestle. And then the next match will be yourself coming out with two Rafikis and a lollipop and doing all this kind of wild stuff instead. Yeah, yeah, so yeah. I know that wrestling is kind of like a circus. You need everything. You need a bit of variety. But when someone sees the likes of yourself or Ravy Davey be another absolute perfect example, that's the kind of, that's wrestlers people remember after a show as well. Again, that's me and my soapbox, so let's get down off it.
Well, I mean, like, you're right. I mean, like, who is the most popular wrestler, like, in Scotland of all time? I'd say, yeah, Grado, 100%. Like, I mean, Drew might be signed. Drew might be, like, former WWE champion. But, I mean, to be honest, he's still not as over as Grado. Like, Grado's, like, the number one. Grado's, like, off the back of wrestling, got himself, like, a radio show. He's got himself on TV as well, and not having to do like stupid things to put his body in harm's way, and he's still like living comfortably as well. Like, the guy got it like figured out as well. Like, and he didn't like get himself down about having to get in, you know, ridiculous like behemoth shape. Like, Grado was just like your everyday man, your Dusty Rhodes kind of guy, you know, your common man. But the fact that he was such a character, it got him over, and that just proves as well that it is all about the characters. Like Mick Foley as well. Like, it's I'm a big like believer in wrestling is about characters as well. Because I mean, Steve Austin, like perhaps one of the most over people like ever, but that's because he was like the anti-authority. Like Austin 316, back when he was like the Hollywood Blonde, or back when he was like the Ringmaster, he was still wrestling the same. He didn't really do much else different, but it was his character, and that's what really kind of set him apart as well. So you just need to find that character, like, because I mean, you can wrestle for days, and same with Kurt Angle as well. Like Kurt was like class. Like Kurt can once again wrestle for days, but it was a character that like kind of people bought into. The fact, see, when he started going comedy, that's when like his value just like skyrocketed big time.
Yeah, it's the cliche, work smart, not hard. Yeah, I mean, you like yourself, again, not to say anything bad about anyone, but everyone can do these good wrestling moves, and then you can just come in, put a lollipop in someone's mouth, and get the biggest reaction of the night. So it is. Carlito will be another example. Everyone doing all these fancy moves, he just came out, bit an apple, spit it in someone's face, biggest reaction. So it is just finding that character that suits you, that you feel comfortable with, and that you're comfortable exploring and letting people embrace. Tangents, there we go. See, told you. We're well into the tangents of these things. I'm looking at like time, and I think
apologies.
That's all right. No, definitely not. Don't apologize. But like, we're in 2017, and we're like, not even made it past there, and we're almost a good hour in. So we'll kind of not skip a few things, but we did the Asylum Invitational, like you say, you got to the final against Aaron Echo, who ended up winning the tournament. 2017 saw you made, and into 2018 saw you make like big debuts. You were, of course, PWE with the Team GPWA and the Asylum Elite. You ended up in Newcastle again for MEW. Your 4GW, and in July 2018, of course, Shug's House Party.
Against,
surprise, surprise, for anyone listening, Ravy Davy.
Yeah. So, Ravy, Shug's? Because was...
Oh, actually, no, I am incorrect. No. It was not. It was Garvin.
Lewis. Yeah, Lewis Garvin, because Ravy was the next year. Both of those were very last minute additions as well. So in that, I'd been consistently backstage at ICW, and just kind of waiting for my time essentially. And I'm trying to do everything I can to get on a show. I'm putting on like what I think are these good matches for GPWA, like within Glasgow and then out with as well. I'm in PWE, I'm in Target, I'm in 4GW, and I'm just trying to like build my value essentially, but I'm always kind of chipping away in the background at ICW, and I get told that we need a new backstage interviewer. Do you want to do it? And I was like, yeah, that's fine. Like, I think like, I can have conversations with people, as you can tell here, because we're so far into the podcast just now, the interview, and we're only 2017, 2018. So once again, apologies for that. But I think, right, okay, cool, let's use my strengths and my advantage. And this could be a foot in the door. At least I'm on ICW TV, and from that, build up to matches. And that's the way it worked. So there was a tiny bit of a story behind that, and the fact that like I was interviewing Lewis, and he was kind of like fobbing me off and stuff like that, and eventually I just like snap, I'm like, nah, that's it, I've had enough of that. Like, I mean, you shouldn't really cheat people get anyway, you know, like they are still a human being, but at the end of the day, like I'm number one wrestler first and then interviewer. It just so happened that I was being an interviewer at the time, but like wrestling's still my passion, wrestling's what I want to do, and I got to go to Shug's house party and compete, which was amazing. Like, it was class, and yeah, in hindsight, once again, the match probably could have been a little bit better, because it is that pressure. And for myself, that's probably one of the downsides of being so engrossed in wrestling and so involved in it. Like, you've got all this varying feedback and it's up to you to filter that out. And while being respectful, it's up to you to decide who you listen to and who you don't really listen to as well. So in hindsight, like, that match could have went better as well. And one thing that I really regret about it is, so everyone told me that, listen, see, if you want to be a wrestler, you need to take your top off. Like, you can't wrestle with a t-shirt on. But I was like, do you know what? It's not really like I'm wearing a t-shirt though. It is like part of the outfit. It's part of my brand. It's part of my identity. But the fact that so many people got on to me about taking the t-shirt off, I was like, right, okay, cool, I'm going to do it. And I wanted to have like a Jeff Hardy moment, essentially, where you take the t-shirt off and everyone screams. Like, so I was like, right, cool, this is my moment. I knock Lewis out the ring, I turn around, I'm fired up, and I go to take the t-shirt off. Silence. Nothing. And from that, I was like, oh, this isn't going to be good. And you can't exactly just go, right, cool, I'm going to put this back on. So you have to, like, continue the match with the t-shirt on. So continue the match, do the match. I get actually injured from it at the very end as well, after the Filthy Gen give me their finish, which is like the tombstone double stomp thing. So I land awkwardly on my neck, and I've got a crick in my neck for a few days. But I get backstage, and I get told maybe you should have kept the top on. And I'm like, oh man, like, you can't win. So then the next year, I'm on Chug's house party again, and this is the one with David Davey. But this one, I'm like, once again, really want to make an entrance. So I come out in my Hollywood Hogan gear. So I've got this class gear that, to be fair, I've only actually been able to wrestle in about twice, which is really annoying because I love it so much. But yeah, I've only been able to wrestle it twice. So I come out, I make this entrance. It is kind of like NWO, HMC, and I've got a class t-shirt. Like, this t-shirt, like, I'd love to sell it, but I'd feel too stupid about selling a t-shirt with my face on it. But the t-shirt itself is class. It's so cool. So I come out, and then when, once again, I'm in the moment, I'm in the match, pop Davey. Davey's a heel at this point because he's part of the Dallas Mavericks. So I pop him out and I'm like, right, this is it. I'm firing up big time. And I'm hogging it. Like, I do that. So I've got this like here and I'm hogging it. And then I'm out back in the pictures and I'm like, oh, maybe I should have kept it on. I don't know if that's just me being self-conscious or not, but I'm like, maybe, because it's very easy in wrestling to compare yourself to like the other guys as well. So that's why I'm like, maybe I should have kept that on. But like both experiences were amazing, getting to wrestle in front of like hundreds of fans as well, and kind of continuing the story of myself versus Ravy Davey again.
Another chapter in the long history of the the fight forever, as we discussed. So yeah, as I was going through these, and notice 2019, early 2019, of course, Red Lightning, Rudo Lightning was up in the Northeast, and you end up making your debut against Dino Del Monte up in WrestleZone.
Yes.
So what was it like? I mean, I guess around this time, I think Thatcher Wright also started making appearances up this end of town. What was it like heading up north and getting a different crowd? Because this is a very, very family orientated crowd. I don't know if you've had anything so family oriented, because it's all been big characters, and Sam Barbour Experience seems almost too perfect to be in that environment. So what was it like wrestling up this way?
It was amazing. Like it was amazing. It was weird though. So I, because I was the driver of Red Lightning, I wasn't on the main card. And Dino Del Monte was probably still quite new in the school at the time as well. And this was only his like second or third match. But so we were the pre-show match. So we were the doors open for like the golden ticket holders, and then everyone else like gets in after. So we wrestled in front of at most 11 people. And like it was scary, but it was good, because that made me like try and ramp up. I think I'm like, right, listen, I'm not going to do anything unless it gets a reaction. And it did. And when I went backstage, I got told, you know, that was real good. See, considering that was in front of like 11 people, you done amazing. You gave the crowd what they wanted. You got a reaction out of them. They were allowed back here. It sounded like there was like at least 20 people there. So it seemed like there was more than there was. So that was good. Really enjoyed the match with Dino as well. And WrestleZone, it's somewhere where I really want to be again. Like, well, right now, I won't be anywhere. I just want to kind of get my wrestling fixed. So hopefully in the future, I will be on a WrestleZone card again.
Fingers crossed you are, because then I actually get to see you wrestle live. Because if it's not that, it would be whenever SWA decide to do Inverness again, or whenever, if you end up in W3L up in Elgin once a year. But no, that WrestleZone's like my one chance to get in and see some of the guys, because it's for sake of travel. But you know, it's we're a bit far north to just go on a whim down to places. But I'm hoping to get some more places in the future. But no, I mentioned that one in particular because, like I say, because your character, I thought that would be perfect. And like I say, it was from 11 people, but at least it's like you say, you want to get back there, because it's such an environment for characters. It's 80s, that's what it is. It's golden era 80s, early 90s, even a little bit new gen with the wild kind of weird characters.
That's where I thrive.
I thought that would be a great one just to pick out, and not just because I'm a big WrestleZone fan and I find any excuse to speak about them. But no, that wasn't kind of your last foray with WrestleZone though, because then you made Discovery debut that year, and in a match with the WrestleZone Tri-Counts Championship online. It was Jason Reed, Alexander Dean, and who's the last? Who's the last guy?
So I can only remember him because he was the guy that lost a power of weight.
Fraser Thomas.
Yeah, I couldn't remember his name either. No disrespect to Fraser, but I was like, if we didn't really have that much interaction, anyway, despite being in a match together, But yeah, that wasn't my last interaction with Racerzone in general. And the Tri-County's belt, it's a really, really nice looking belt.
That's like, a great belt.
I wanted that so much, and like, I wanted to be able to represent WrestleZone, and like I loved what Jason was doing. I loved the fact that like, he was taking that belt out with the Tri-Counties and kind of defending it, and that's what I want to do as well. I want to first of all win a belt and then like take it under my wing and just kind of increase its value. So yeah, massive respect to Jason for what he was doing. And unfortunately, that was my night that night. It was me that got pinned at the end of the day. But yeah, like, and I was hoping down the line to perhaps wrestle for it again, but it never came to fruition, unfortunately.
But what was it like getting the call for Discovery? Because I mean, I would say even now they're probably one of the top, at least top three, top two companies in the country.
Yeah, Discovery is where I want to work big time. Like I said, I've already wrestled for them a few times, but like I'm not quite a Discovery mainstay. I'm not quite like a proper Rosa member. And I'd just love to be considered one. Like I've got like so many ideas in the bank that I'm saving for when I do eventually get that call again, get that message. Because Discovery, it's amazing. Like the stars that they've had over the few years that they've brought like to the table, it's just amazing. Like it's definitely one of the hidden gems of British wrestling. Like more people should have their eyes on Discovery. Discovery, as you said, like within the top two promotions in the country, and it's a place where I love to be. Just because like the crowd's amazing, and like backstage as well, it's just like such a good atmosphere as well. I've been to the Jam House a few times, and I've been to the Corn Exchange as well, which is very cool.
Yeah, it's that hybrid crowd. It's got that they'll take your Dalton Castles like as an example. Someone like yourself as in this big character, and then you've got your guys like Joe Hendry, even though he's got the big character, or Andy Wilde, that's probably a better example. Someone who might not have as much of a character, but has got the in-ring chops to kind of compensate for it. So it's got a nice little hybrid of people. Speaking of Discovery, and not so really speaking of Discovery, but their champion, you ended up doing a series of podcasts with Joe Hendry.
Yeah,
as well. So how did that come about? And was your kind of, I think was it called how to build a pro wrestler?
How to be a pro wrestler?
How to be a pro wrestler? Yeah. So yeah, how did that come about?
So that came about because I reached out to Joe. So Joe, like I've got a lot of time for Joe. Like I massively, massively respect Joe and what he does, and the fact that like he is very much character led as well, but it's proven as well, like in the fact that he's a Commonwealth champion, you know, like if he's still wrestling, like that's him. Like if he puts his mind to it, then he's going to do it. And he's been signed by like two major companies as well, not at that point, but it was just amazing. And before that, like I know it sounds a bit stupid, but I could see like the drive and determination of Joe. And he at that time believed that social media was such a big thing. So I reached out to him and I was like, Joe, listen, my following isn't exactly grown. And I see you've got a podcast. Like I'd love to sponsor it. Like just like because you must have like so many viewers that like are looking for like other wrestlers to follow as well, and like hopefully I can be one of them. So I reached out and I said, can I sponsor the podcast? Just give me a wee shout out. Like I'm trying to get myself out there. I'm trying to do these things. And he respected that as well. He respected that like I was a real kind of go-getter at the time. And I was like, yeah, love to help you. we came up with this strategy. Unfortunately, it didn't pay off in growing the numbers, but it was just amazing to like be featured on the podcast and like kind of tell my story a wee bit as well. And like I kind of grew a friendship with Joe essentially as well at the time, which was good.
Definitely a guy that if you see someone hustling, he's like, that's his, I mean, you hear on the podcast, that's his whole deal. He'll keep hustling until he gets an opportunity, and he'll just keep hustling till the next and making the most of it. And he's a good role model and probably a confidant to have there available to
massive respect for him.
Run ideas to. So if anyone else wants to go, got any more time, once you've checked out the 130 podcasts I've done, go check out Joe Henry's. I still listen to them every week when they come out with when he has the time, of course, because he's a very busy man. Incredible. I don't know how he even has time to do a podcast. So a couple more questions, and then we'll kind of, I think we've got a part two somewhere in the future here, just because we've got, again, between video games and all that kind of stuff, we could be here forever. But we've got your trip to Ireland. So you did a seminar in Ireland. They end up wrestling Paul Tracy as well. So what was that like, his experience?
I brought Paul Tracy out of retirement again. So Paul was retired at the time, and he hadn't wrestled in a number of years, at least a couple of years anyway, at that point. That was a situation where we didn't find out until the night before that we were wrestling. So we had this week-long seminar, essentially. So I think it's like Monday to Friday with the show on the Saturday. And so it was essentially proving ground. Like Monday to Friday was proving ground. Cut your teeth, show them why you should be in the show, show them why you want to be in the show. And yeah, that was really good. Like that seminar is absolutely invaluable. Like probably it's not the best like experience of my career, or maybe the second best experience of my career, kind of top two anyway for sure. The other one being going to WXW in Germany. But yeah, so that, like, I've made kind of friends for life through Ireland. Really enjoyed that, and I got to show like other people that, like, I'm in business, and I got to show people like from Scotland as well, because like there was people who flew over for the seminar that I'd never stepped in a ring with before, so like they could kind of scope me out, get a feel for me, I could kind of scope them out, get a feel for them as well. But I'm impressed with the character, and my match ended up a gauntlet match. So there was a gauntlet match with promos in between each opponent as well. So I had to cut three promos maybe, because it was the intro promo. Then, yeah, three promos that I had to cut, which is cool, because it kind of kept establishing my character more and more and more as well, until I faced the big boss, Paul Tracy, who was making his return to Irish wrestling. As well, so that was amazing. It was fantastic, and I'm very thankful that I got put in a gauntlet match as well, because it meant that I got to share the ring with three different people as well, and gain the experience from that rather than like just one. I'm not saying like anyone who just shares the ring with one person like you get any less, but it was cool just to have a wee bit of variety and like change up my style essentially throughout the match as well, because like one like match could be like heavy hitting, one could be like technical, and it could like showcase my abilities and my generalness, I guess. Jack of all trades, master in them.
You're maximizing your opportunity in that moment. If you're only going to be in Ireland once, you'd be as well get three matches, get Paul Tracy out of retirement, and do all the promos you can muster in that time. Yeah. Get all the time you can. So of course, pandemic hit. February 2020 was your last match that I've got noted anyway. Was your SWA debut. You may have had possibly had a wrestling experience in Scotland in there somewhere as well. but I haven't written it down. And then, of course, extended break back October 2021 for Community Pro Wrestling. Well, during that time, were you just getting yourself into the shape of your life kind of thing? Did you think this is never going to happen? And what was it like getting in front of a crowd again?
So it was a hard time, because there were moments during that pandemic where I had to have a serious word with myself and think, is this what you want to do? Like, you really, and I think everyone kind of had a word with themselves essentially and kind of prioritized where they want to be in life and like evaluated like everything that was in their life. I had a few conversations with myself about it. And I always question whether I still want to do this anymore, because like I'm not exactly old, but I just felt that I was getting quite stagnant as well. And I wasn't really kind of progressing at the rate that I wanted to. And I seen others around me just kind of like take off, and I just felt that I was in the dust essentially. And like people, I'm not exactly shiny and new anymore like I once was. Like, oh, okay, what's that? Like, very good, and that's it, you know. Whereas like some, like back in the day, oh cool, it's Sam, like what's he going to do next and stuff like that. So yeah, I had to have a conversation with myself. So it was very kind of touch and go for a while, and at one point I just told myself like I wasn't going to come back. But even if I tell myself that I'm not going to come back to wrestling, I will never ever announce it. I will never say this is my retirement from wrestling, because people never stick to it. People always get the itch. People come back. It's ridiculous. It's turned into a bit of a joke, essentially. Like, I know a few people who said, oh, I'm retiring from wrestling. And then, like, they come back a month later. And like, yeah, come on, man. Like, what's that all about? And, like, it's a bit disrespectful to people as well, because, like, they get, like, the, oh, my God, like, please don't go, I've changed, stuff like that. You know, it's disrespectful to them, which I think. So, like, if I ever decide that I'm, like, that's it, I'm calling it a day, like, I'm never going to announce it. I'm just going to kind of fade into the black. Davey and I, we had a conversation as well, and he told me that he's running Community Pro Wrestling. And I was like, right, okay, cool. I want to be a part of this, because this is a person that I trust, that has got, like, the wrestler's intentions, best intentions, like, at heart. As well, but not only that, the fact that like he's doing it in his hometown, and like wrestling's for the kids as well. I mean, that's probably how you and I both got into it, like while we were children as well. And that's what I was saying earlier about like reviews, people reviewing WrestleMania 2000, like you need to look at it from like a kid's standpoint, how they love it. And yeah, so I've got a young cousin who used to come to all my shows kind of pre-pandemic, and I still kind of want to do it for him as well, so he can see it. His big cousin's a wrestler, so when CPW came up, I was like, yeah, cool, I want it. And then when I got told it was against CJ West as well, now, like, by the way, like, CJ West is one of my best friends, like, and we only met in Ireland like during that first seminar. Like, but since then we kept in touch. I went back over to Ireland as well, so I've been over to Ireland twice, and I ended up kind of staying in his house, like he stayed in mine. Like the fact that I got told it was against CJ West, like that kind of meant a lot as well. I'm like, right, cool, I cannot say no to this. So with that in mind, and I said I had these conversations with myself, I thought like, the character's getting a bit stagnant, so I've somewhat rebranded the Handsome Man's Club, if you will. So the Handsome Man's Club doesn't mean what it once meant as well. So the Handsome Man's Club originally was, I'm better than you, I'm more handsome, you're ugly, blah, blah. And it was basic, but it was fine. But now the Handsome Man's Club, as you may be able to see on the t-shirt that I'm currently selling on sambarbourx.bigcartel.com. So with that, you've got the pink balaclavas, and that's what we came out with at the end of CPW, the pink balaclavas, myself, got Cairo and Levi Justice. Now the three of us are the Handsome Man's Club with the Pink Balaclavas, and the Pink Balaclavas, like, we want to be essentially the face of the facelift. I know that's a bit of a cliche, but like, Handsome Man's Club is now an all-inclusive group, and it, like, despite having the name or the word man in it, it's not necessarily just men who are in it. Like, you can be any nature, any creed, as long as you're a good person, and not a bad guy. Like, you can join the Handsome Man's Club. And you want, as a Handsome Man's Club, I want to give that a wee bit of hope back as well. Those people who maybe think that they got forgotten about a wee bit, I want to kind of bring them back to the surface as well, and like, use my status, just the stats of the Handsome Man's Club, to elevate that as well.
Right, so we're going to get into it. We've got one question in from Mike Devine. He just asked, when is the big fur coat making its return?
So the fur coat was a massive part of my moniker back in the original days of the Sam Barbour Experience, and since then, like, the character has evolved a bit, as I just said. But I mean, what's old can be new again. So the jacket might make an appearance sooner than later.
And if we ask everyone, we've got two questions. I don't know if you listen to any previous podcast, but we've got two questions we ask everyone. They're not wrestling related, they're just stupid. But the first one is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
One cow. Has a cow ever chased you?
No, but a lamb has.
Right, okay, cool. If a lamb chases you, you can just kick it. See, if a cow chases you, oh my days, it's terrifying. Like, it would trample you. So two cow, like, one cow or two sheep, like, any day of the week.
Fair enough. I like the thought process. I love it. Love it. Some people just give me an answer and have no further thought, and then there's others that just come up with it with, like, justifying this ridiculous question. I love it.
Yeah.
And the other one we ask is, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Oh, that is a good question. I was never really a dinosaur fan when I was younger.
Well, that's the interview over, so that's fine.
Hey, man.
It could be anything. It could be dinosaur related. So if you're a big Power Rangers guy, if you're a big...
Yeah, that's whatever. What I was going to say, man. Like, I want to go, like, Tyrannosaurus, like, Red Power Ranger, big time, man. Like, I'll go for Tyrannosaurus before they turn into gorilla.
Excellent choice. Excellent choice. Oh god, don't.
Like, Ivan Ooze.
Oh god, the Power Rangers movie. It was still better than the one that they came out with more recently, but you know.
Yeah.
They got rid of the Tyrannosaurus Rex, the T-Rex Megazord, and I don't think I've T-Rex Zord. I don't think I've really forgiven them for that. Like I say, we've had so many tangents that we're going to have to get part two sometime in the future, because I think we're kind of the same age. We kind of started at the same time. We've got very similar experiences in terms of fandom. So we've got a lot more we can speak about. But the last question I try to ask people now, before your social media plugs, because of course we'll get them in. Dream match. So you've got main event at WrestleMania, or choose whatever company is the biggest show, if you're a big Japan guy, whatever. You get to book the main event with yourself in it. Any opponents, any match, who would it be?
Now, I would have, do you know, massive respect for Rikishi, but I mean, let's take him out. See the Armageddon, Hell in a Cell. I would love to have been a part of that, like, replacing Rikishi. Like, so you've got, I mean, it's a bit greedy, but you've got The Undertaker, you've got The Rock, you've got Stone Cold, you've got Kurt Angle, and you've got Triple H. And then, like, SPX is next. Obviously, the SPX isn't really fit in, but that would...
Fine.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, like, see if it means that I need to get thrown off the cell into a hay bale truck, then... So be it, but oh my days, like, the star power in that match, and like, you never really get anything like that. Like, I prefer the Armageddon Hell in a Cell over Elimination Chambers, because it was just such a big smoz, and it was so cool, and it's the fact that you can climb to the top And then from that, stuff happens.
That's the answer. This is, yeah, this is why we're definitely getting a part two in the future. So that's a, yeah, excellent answer. So before we wrap up then, where can people find out more about the Sam Barbour Experience online?
So you can find me, I try and keep all my handles the same now. So on Twitter and Instagram, that's what I use most. It's at Sam Barbour X. And on Facebook, which I probably haven't updated in quite a while, it's the Sam Barbour Experience. So that's where you can find me. But Instagram is probably the main one as well. So that's a wee bit of an insight into my life as well. Maybe some food as well, because everyone loves some food. And obviously wrestling related stuff as well.
Well, thank you very much for letting me join the experience today. You've been part of the SWN Spotlight. SWN podcast experience. But yeah, thank you very much.
Appreciate that. Thanks so much, brother.